Welcome back. You're watching our special broadcast on Supreme Court's landmark verdict against instant triple talaq. That practice has just been held unconstitutional by a 3-2 majority of the Supreme Court. We have been speaking with Mr. Mohan Parasaran and Mr. Mahesh Jethmalani, and we are now being joined by Additional Solicitor General Pinky Anand as well. Ms. Anand, thank you very much for joining us. Just to put something which Mr. Parasaran anyway clarified, but since you were in the court and involved so intimately with the case, this is not incumbent on any law being passed by Parliament. That was a minority view, and the majority view is that as of today, instant triple talaq is unconstitutional?
Absolutely, you're right. I mean, the whole judgment proceeds on the assumption that it is three judges have voted in favor of striking down triple talaq as unconstitutional. The Chief Justice has given a dissenting judgment and a certain view whether legislation should be done or not, but really that is a dissenting judgment. So the majority view will prevail, and as of today, triple talaq is unconstitutional in this country, thankfully.
Okay, yes, of course, and jubilation as well. Ms. Anand, can the arguments advanced by the judges in the judgment be used to extend it to the other forms of triple talaq as well? It's only talaq-e-biddat that has been outlawed at this point in time as arbitrary and whimsical. Can we use the same arguments, and can another petitioner extend the judgment to cover other forms of talaq, triple talaq?
You have a very valid point. In fact, this issue came up when the matter was started to be heard. Mm. And in fact, the address was to all the forms of malpractices that are there, including other forms of talaq and including halala and all. But the court confined the issue to triple talaq itself, talaq-e-biddat, which has been considered. And definitely the entire, not window, but a door or entire area has been opened up for consideration of other practices that can be struck down. Of course, to be struck down, they have to be considered as unconstitutional and violative of whether the rights of dignity, of life, liberty, of arbitrariness, all these parameters would have to be met. But it has opened the field for this entire consideration, and it will be an issue which would be considered in appropriate matters.
Okay. I'm glad that you say that the judgment has opened the door wide, because I intend to walk into that door and ask, push the envelope further. Can the arguments used in this case, in this landmark case, be used to also now attack polygamy, another problem which only Muslim women face, perhaps more sharply than other women in India?
Much as, you know, the entire practice of even polygamy is something which has been declared to be against dignity on various fronts, but the point remains that when you are in a court, the issues that have to be considered are whether the same is unconstitutional, whether it is a practice which is derogatory, whether it's a practice that is violative of women's rights, of equality, of gender discrimination. So all these features would have to be considered individually in that case. Whenever you're considering a practice, you have to test the practice against its own contours. Just for example, I'm pointing out to you that in talaq-e-biddat, triple talaq, in fact, even the Muslim board had said that they would advise this practice not to be used by the general people, because it was something which was not, in fact, also it was considered not essential. So, you know, it was an optional part. And this is what Justice Joseph, in fact, in his judgment has considered, that it is not even a commonly accepted practice as such. And it is considered what they say bad in theology. So you'll have to use this, if you want to use this judgment, it will be have to be used in its entire parameters across board for consideration of the other practices such as polygamy. Having said that, I mean, today I think a number of those features would come in definitely very useful and would apply to polygamy practices also, which incidentally seems to have outlived any modicum of civilized society.
Okay. Would you agree to that, Mr. Parasaran? Do you think we have taken the first step towards even attacking polygamy with this judgment?
Yeah, certainly. From the point of view of public policy considerations and from constitutional morality as well, I think I think the world has changed. I think we have taken a giant leap forward.
Mr. Jethmalani, what would your view be? Have the scales tilted adequately in favour of Article 14 and adequately away from perhaps an overemphasis of Articles 25 to 27, that we will be probably able to see the end of polygamy as well, at least as far as the law is concerned?
Well, again, I have to say that this is a very tiny opening of the door.
Okay.
You have to put your foot in and push it, you know, wide ajar for other practices which are reprehensible to sensibility, equality, and morality generally, for that kind of radical change to take place. This was a very, very narrow issue.
Okay.
Door has been opened, but it's a long way ahead.
Okay. Well, take your point, sir, but still, hope springs eternal. Ms. Anand chooses to look at it as a door that's even wider open. But, well, we will have to wait for the law to be tried and judgments to come in. Ms. Anand, now let me check if a whole wall can be broken. Can judgments like these be used as precedents now to attack gender biases in the majority community? You know, in this specific case, there is a large amount of public opinion as well as, legal backing for the minority, because a majority of the women already had these rights. So it is very clearly a case of inequality which was being practiced on probably 7% of the Indian population, the Muslim women. Now, can we say that we can use this judgment to perhaps ensure better inheritance rights for Hindu women? That is, generally better rights for women in general in India. Is there that much fire in this law, in this judgment?
There is. Well, I'll tell you, to be honest, I think, first of all, we've made leaps and bounds in inheritance laws in most of the communities. Mm-hmm. And you've come to a situation of equality, at least as far as the law stands. Implementation and choosing to enforce it may be another proposition. Mm-hmm. But having said that, this particular judgment deals with not only gender equality and gender inequality, so
yes,
to say, but also deals with aspects of whether, this was a essential practice, whether indeed you could have Article 25 was subject to public order, morality, health, and all those considerations. But ultimately veers around to holding that you cannot have such arbitrary or deprecatory practices which are violative of human dignity. Mm-hmm. So that would, of course, apply across board to any community, mm-hmm, to any practices, majority or minority,
yeah,
because this is inter se, in fact, the community itself. So it is between, for example, in this case, it is between females and males.
Yes.
The males go under 1939 law and apply for talaq under the law as it stands. And as far as women were concerned, they could be given triple talaq by just pronouncement without judicial intervention. Mm. But you will find some added features. For example, one of the issues that was considered was there was no judicial intervention in talaq-e-biddat.
Mm.
So these features would be relevant only for talaq-e-biddat, would not necessarily be relevant for other issues.
Mm.
So, whenever it comes to gender discrimination, but I'll tell you one thing.
Mm.
Courts and the parliament have been extremely progressive in trying to amend these laws as and when the situation has arisen. So definitely, parallels from this would be useful, directly or indirectly.
Mm-hmm. What's your take, Mr. Parasaran? Can we now extend this to getting gender rights, more equal gender rights, even in cases where the majority communities' rules are involved or codes are involved?
See, already I think we have made lots of progress.
Mm.
And as Mahesh was saying, actually this is only a beginning.
Mm.
And already people have woken up to their rights.
Mm.
And as I said, I think this is only a eye-opener, and society is going to progress, and we can't make too many things into this judgment.
Okay.
And we'll have to wait and see,
Okay. So, Mr. Jethmalani, would you agree, and I think you have been holding this view, that at the moment the Supreme Court has not quite changed the bias in favour of Articles 14 to that extent many of the other gender biases in, Hindu codes and in Muslim codes can be banned. Just yet, we don't have that much from the Supreme Court judgment.
Well, the Supreme Court had an opportunity to take a huge leap into the future because the Attorney General said that all three forms of talaq, Ehsan and Hasan as well, should be held to be illegal and unconstitutional. But the Supreme Court said, no, look, the petitioners have really come with the Talaq-e Bidat issue. The people,
yes.
the women who came there said that Talaq-e Bidat was oppressive to them,
okay.
Right? It took away their dignity and their right to equality and so on. But the Supreme Court didn't go into it. It could have, but it didn't, which is why I'm a little disappointed, whatever the verdict may have been. I'm also a little disappointed by the stand of the All India Muslim Personal Law Board on this issue, because they themselves conceded that they advise women now to, when they go for their nikah namaz, to say that, our divorce will not be governed by Talaq-e-Bidat.
Oh.
And still, although they make that advice, they were still resistant to the Supreme Court striking down Talaq-e-Bidat. So, ultimately, it became a control issue on the part of the All India Muslim Law Board. And I found that a little unfortunate. So, while this judgment has opened the door a very tiny bit, there's a lot to be disappointed about also.
Okay. Yes, of course, sir. I take your point, Ms. Pinky Anand, Mr. Mohan Parasaran and Mr. Mahesh Jethmalani. Thank you very much for joining us and enlightening us about the extent to which the envelope can be pushed with this judgment on gender biases being removed. There is no denying that this is a landmark verdict, and this has definitely pushed gender equality a little more. Perhaps the door needs to be opened wider, and we have to wait for more judgments and more cases to try Indian law so that more gender biases in both Hindu code, Muslim code and other religious codes are removed. That doesn't take away from the importance and the landmark nature of today's judgment. Before we leave, here's what other eminent lawyers had to say about the Supreme Court judgment. Thank you very much for joining us on this show.
We injunct this instant triple talaq in one sitting. He doesn't talk about talaq-e-ehsan and talaq-e-hasan. Those are upheld.
It is a conclusion that will bring relief to women. This is for society. This is for men, women alike.
We need to salute the Muslim woman today who fought for it. The new statement of empowerment of women of India.
Majority is held to be unconstitutional, so it's unconstitutional. Frankly, I'm disappointed. I would have been happy if there had been an unanimous judgment in a matter of this nature.
ये इसके जो परिणाम आने वाले हैं वो सिर्फ तीन तलाक तक सीमित नहीं रहेंगे. ये जबरदस्त फैसला है.